Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Brenton Brown. I am the Director of Public Policy and Community Affairs for the South Carolina Commission for Minority Affairs. It is my pleasure to welcome you to today's unemployment benefits webinar between the Commission for Minority Affairs and the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce. CMA was established in 1993 to be a catalyst for socioeconomic change for the state's ethnic minority communities. As such, we work to ensure that all the state's ethnic minority residents are treated equitably and achieve economic prosperity through sociocultural awareness, collaboration, policy change, and research. With us today, we have a sister agency here in the state of South Carolina, and we have members of the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce. SCDEW's mission is to promote and support an effective customer-driven workforce system that facilitates financial stability and economic prosperity for employers, individuals, and communities. This mission supports their vision to be viewed as an efficient, transparent, customer-friendly partner in providing quality workforce solutions. In accordance with our agency's dual mission to uplift communities, we've identified the importance of connecting minority communities to economic resources, especially during this COVID-19 pandemic. Today, we will learn more about unemployment insurance, which is a nationwide program created to financially help eligible individuals who are unemployed through no fault of their own while they are actively seeking new work. And we will also discuss other employment matters. Following the remarks period, we will have a question and answer period. Our panelists for today's session are all members of the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce. Today, we have Mr. Brent Phillips. He is the Unemployment Insurance Operations Director. Ms. Laretha Santiago, an Unemployment Insurance Special Projects, with Unemployment Insurance Special Projects, and Mr. Todd Timmons, Chief Legal Officer for the Department of Employment and Workforce. Once again, after their remarks, they will answer questions about unemployment benefits especially as we deal with the COVID-19 pandemic. So without further delay, I present to you Mr. Phillips, Ms. Santiago, and Mr. Timmons.
Good morning. This is actually Paul Familari. I am the Deputy General Counsel for the Department of Employment and Workforce. Mr. Timmons was unavailable to take this call, so I'm going to pitch in for him here. I really appreciate the opportunity to speak to everyone here and to provide as much information to the audience as possible about the unemployment insurance benefits that may be available to our community that is in such dire need. So to provide some perspective of the challenges that we are all facing in the state, in all of 2019, we had about 120,000 people file a claim for benefits, and that was for the entire year of 2019. Over the last 5 weeks or so, since the COVID-19 pandemic hit, we have had over 350,000 claims filed. So we've had about 3 years worth of claim volume in 5 weeks. So that's been an extraordinary challenge for the agency and for the citizens of the state who we are committed to serving. You know, we've taken a lot of steps to ease access. We've increased our customer service representatives by over 400% to handle the incoming volume of claims and call questions. We've taken steps with the assistance of the governor in waiving the ordinarily required waiting week that people have to serve before actually receiving benefits. We've waived the ordinary requirement to perform two job searches on the South Carolina Works Online Service job bank system. And there are, in addition to unemployment insurance, the normal state program, there are a couple of significant federal aid programs that have been passed by Congress that our agency is tasked with implementing and overseeing in this state. The first of those is the Federal Pandemic Unemployment Compensation Program, and that provides an additional $600 of federal money each week to every claimant, every individual who is eligible for unemployment insurance, whether that's state unemployment insurance or federal unemployment insurance. You will get whatever your weekly benefit amount is under that program, and then an additional $600 from the federal government on top of that. And that money is available for claim weeks ending April 4th, 2020, through the claim week ending July 25th, 2020. I think that's about 17 weeks or so that that money will be available to people who are unemployed and receiving some form of state or federal unemployment benefit. The next major program is the Pandemic Unemployment Assistance Program. And that is the program that is available to the self-employed, to gig economy workers, independent contractors, and all other individuals who may not otherwise be eligible for any other state or federal unemployment insurance program. And in addition, those people are unemployed, unable to work, or unavailable to work as a direct result of one of about 10 different COVID-19 related criteria. We have been working feverishly to get this program up and running. The federal law that created it was passed less than 4 weeks ago. And so it has been, we have been working very, very, very hard to get that program up and running. We anticipate being able to process those claims by the end of this weekend. We're cautiously optimistic. For all those who have already gone through and filed a claim for unemployment insurance benefits and have received notification that you are ineligible because you're self-employed and we don't have any covered wages in our system, we are going to reach out to you directly when that program is up and available and provide you with the information you need to move forward to process that claim. And we are very, very close to being able to implement that program in this state. And I should mention that the $600 federal program, that additional payment, we implemented that about 2 weeks ago. We've been paying that for the last two or so weeks. So we're pleased with that. And the last significant federal program that will eventually be available is the Pandemic Emergency Unemployment Compensation Program. And that will provide an additional 13 weeks of state unemployment insurance benefits after someone exhausts their normal 20 weeks of state UI. So once we get the PUA program for self-employed people up and running, we're going to then turn our attention to the PEUC program so that we'll be able to provide those additional 13 weeks of state unemployment insurance benefits to those people who would qualify. And we anticipate having that program up sometime in early May, early to mid-May. And that's a broad overview of the situation facing the agency and the steps that we've taken to support our fellow South Carolinians and to provide them all of the benefits, whether state or federal, that they are eligible to receive to help them make it through this unprecedented situation.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Famolari. We also have on the line with us, on the webinar with us as well, is Ms. Laretha Santiago, who is also with the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce. So, Ms. Santiago.
We're trying to help everyone the best that we can. Everyone's claim is very specific. I know I already received some emails with some questions, and we're working diligently to handle those claims one at a time. But unfortunately, that is the process, is that it is one at a time, but we are trying to get to everyone as fast as possible. Hopefully today we'll be able to answer some very broad questions that will help everyone get through the process. However, what I will ask is that if you do have specific questions in regards to your claim, Brinson, if you could navigate those and send those to myself and Mr. Phillips, we will go ahead and try to address those on a specific case-by-case manner.
Okay, we will definitely do that. What I do see here from monitoring the chat function, we do have one question. This question is, are the benefits retroactive from the date in which a person was laid off? And if you could not get through to apply, how could you go about doing that?
Sure. So we are going to, it will be retroactive back to the date that you got laid off. So it's very important whenever you file your claim that it's going to ask you what is your last day worked. So go ahead and put the correct last day worked in there. So what's going to happen, we're going to, you'll get through the claim process. It's going to set up an effective date. However, you may have to speak with us to call and ask for that back date to be done on your claim. But as long as the last day worked matches to what you're stating, we will go ahead and grant that. We have been allowed some flexibility from the government. We do realize that claimants are having a hard time getting through to us. Some may be struggling with the application itself. So we are being flexible with those requests.
Okay, thank you very much. We have another question. Do you offer language services for people that speak a language other than English?
Hey, this is Brent. I appreciate you I appreciate the opportunity to be on this call. We do. We do have translators available. If we know that someone needs an additional translator to help get through the unemployment process and the different services we offer, we do contract with those services to make sure that we can help individuals apply for benefits and go through this process.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. We have a question from Facebook. If an individual is reduced to part-time or as-needed status during this epidemic and their earnings exceed the weekly benefit amount, will that individual still be eligible for the federal unemployment benefit of $600 for that particular week?
The answer to that question, unfortunately, is no. In South Carolina, the definition of unemployed is someone who isn't working at all, obviously, and then also someone who is working their weekly benefit amount. So part-time hours is defined as fewer than 29 hours. So if you are working fewer than 29 hours in a week and you're earning less than your weekly benefit amount, then you would be considered partially unemployed, and then you would be eligible to receive partial unemployment benefits for that week. Now, the weekly benefit amount would be reduced, but you would still receive some amount of unemployment insurance benefits. And as long as you receive a single dollar of state unemployment insurance benefits or whatever the underlying program that you're receiving benefits under, then you will receive the additional $600 on top of that. But the way our law is written, if you earn more than your weekly benefit amount, then you don't meet the statutory definition of unemployed and therefore would not be eligible to receive any benefits for that week.
Thank you very much. Another question we have, what is the best advice for people that are trying to apply and have issues with the online application? For example, they may not remember their password or the system continues to tell them that they don't qualify. What should these people do in that particular instance?
So I think that's a two-part question. So for those who are having issues with just filing their claim in general, unfortunately, they are going to have to keep trying to call into our IVR, and they will be transferred at some point to a representative who can assist them with filing their claim over the phone with them. I did hear you say a piece about someone who is ineligible. Now, that's a completely different situation. If you're found ineligible, I would honestly ask that whoever submitted that question, if they could provide you with their contact information. That seems very claim specific, but when we're talking about unemployment insurance, you could be found ineligible in regards to your monetary, whether you have enough wages out in your base period. It could be for your separation reason, and it could also be for an availability issue. So that one is kind of hard for me to answer, but if they'll provide you with their information, we'll reach out to that person.
And one thing I'll add to that as well, and Paul did an excellent job speaking on it, is there may have been times, and just with the volume, it would have been difficult to reach us. Mm-hmm. And I know that can be very frustrating. We have continually added staff, and we are continually doing that, training staff to be able to answer more questions as they come in. So I know it could have been frustrated, and it still may be in the beginning to reach us with the volume we're facing, but we're adding more staff, we're training more staff to be able to do more things. So I think the folks should be able to get to us a little bit easier, and we can help those people who do need help filing.
Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate that. We have a few more questions. If an individual has exhausted their state unemployment benefits, are they eligible to receive the $600 benefit in addition to the state benefit?
Okay, so there are a couple things to consider in answering this question. There may be some additional federal benefits that would be available once we get those programs up and running. The first is the PUA program, which is available to people who are not otherwise eligible for any other benefit program and who are unemployed as a direct result of COVID. So those people may be able to apply under that program, and if they're eligible under that program and start receiving benefits under that program, they will get the $600 through the week ending July 25th, depending on how many weeks they are eligible. The other one is the program I mentioned earlier, the PEUC, Pandemic Emergency Unemployment Compensation Program, that will provide an additional 13 weeks of state benefits to people who have exhausted their 20 weeks. Once that program is up and running in this state, which again, I think we're a couple of weeks away, early mid-May, then that is going to be another opportunity where people who have exhausted their state UI benefits can receive benefits under that program. And if they're eligible under that program, they will also receive the additional $600 federal payment through the week ending July 25th, 2020.
Okay, thank you. We have another question. Are church workers receiving 1099s eligible for benefits?
They are potentially eligible for benefits under the PUA program, which is for self-employed, gig workers, 1099 workers. That's really the catch-all program for people who are not eligible or would not qualify for any other state or federal benefit program and who are unemployed or unable to work or unavailable to work as a direct result of one of 10 specific COVID-19 related reasons. And so that would include church workers, since they are exempt from state unemployment law, they would then fall under this federal program.
Okay, thank you. Another question that we have, is a salaried employee eligible for some sort of unemployment compensation if they have a reduction in pay? So for example, if they're receiving only about 66% of their normal pay.
Again, this goes back to our state definition of unemployed. And somebody is if someone is working during a claim work, they can be potentially considered partially unemployed if they are working less than 29 hours and earning less than their weekly benefit amount. So if you meet those criteria, then you may be eligible for some form of benefits. But if you're working more than 29 hours in a week, or you're earning more than whatever your established weekly benefit amount is, then you would not be considered unemployed for that week, and you would not be eligible for unemployment insurance benefits.
Okay, it looks like another question that we have. What is the best process for applying if a person does not have access to the internet or a computer? Many of our rural areas do not have internet access other than via a mobile phone. So what should persons without internet access do to apply?
Thank you. There's numerous ways to apply, and we're going to make sure we do all we can to help individuals apply. It is an online process. The process is online, and it is recommended that an individual does their best to find a way to apply for so many reasons, for security information, things that they enter on that they need to, just for privacy purposes. But, and I can speak to this really clear because I live in one of these rural areas, we will do all we can to make sure we help that person file their claim. So if they don't have access to internet or to a computer, and they reach out to us, we will help them file their claim. We'll process it for them over the phone, and we'll do everything we need to do so they can file. We won't prevent anyone from filing. We do try to encourage people to file on their own and to find a way to file. But at the end of the day, if they can't, we will handle them over the phone.
Thank you, sir. Another question, if someone is initially denied benefits, is there an appeal process?
There is an appeals process. I would caution, though, with the new federal programs, we've had so many people, so many independent contractors and self-employed people file a claim for regular unemployment insurance benefits, which is the first step in that process. Those people are all going to be denied unemployment insurance benefits because they don't have any covered wages. to establish a valid UI claim because they're self-employed. For those people, we ask that they not file an appeal. We're going to be reaching out to them directly to give them the instructions on how to file for the federal benefits that they will be potentially eligible for once that's up and running. However, if you are on regular state unemployment insurance benefits, you have a valid claim, and you've been disqualified because we said you were at fault in your job separation or something along those lines, there is an appeals process, and that process is detailed on the piece of paper, the determination that you will receive. Generally, you've got 10 calendar days from the date of that determination to file an appeal. But again, I do want to reiterate, if the reason that you've been denied is because you can't establish a valid UI claim, don't appeal that. We're going to reach out to those folks directly when the PUA program is available and set them up on that process because we don't want to overload our appeals staff, and it's just going to get dismissed if we take a look at it and see that that's what the situation is.
Okay. We have a question about a balance. If someone has a remaining balance that is low, what should they do in that particular case?
So if they have a remaining balance that is low, they're going to continue to file for their unemployment until they exhaust their benefits. Now, low is relative, so I'm not exactly sure how soon they plan on exhausting, how many weeks they have left to file. However, there is a program coming up in the future, and that's what Paul spoke about, is the pandemic emergency unemployment compensation program. That is the next program that we plan to roll out after we get PUA rolled out. That person would potentially then become eligible for the PEUC program. Unfortunately, they may have to wait a few weeks depending on when they exhaust before they can start receiving benefits again. However, those benefits will be retroactive.
Thank you. We have a question that says, how do I correct an error that I made in the filing process?
So there's not a way for them on their portal to correct an error that they made in the process. What they would need to do is call us at our 866 number and speak with a representative. At that point, a representative can put a note in their claim or potentially adjudicate the issue based on the statement that they made an error.
Okay. It looks like we have a question from Twitter. This person says, will I have to sign up for PUA even though I already signed up for unemployment and was determined ineligible because of monetary status?
So the answer to that is yes. Like Paul stated, the first step in the process is applying for unemployment insurance benefits and being found monetarily ineligible to become potentially eligible for the PUA program. The PUA application will have different questions on it. It is more centered to those who are self-employed, 1099 gig workers. It'll be a little bit easier for them to flow through because those questions will make more sense. During that application process, they do have the ability to upload their financial statements and documents that we are requesting for the PUA application.
Thank you. It was mentioned earlier, and of course we understand that we have record levels of people who are applying for unemployment. Is SEDU currently offering work from home opportunities to job seekers to assist them with the increase in call volume?
So going along with the governor's orders, all state agencies have done their best to have staff work remotely, and we're no different. We have done everything we can to have staff available working remotely to help in the call centers. We do have staff available in a number of ways. New staff that we are bringing on, it is sometimes a little difficult to start right from home. So there's an onboarding process that has to take place. But yes, to answer the question, at this point, we're doing all we can to have as many agents on the phone and working from home. Could be and can be and has been an option, but that initial training and onboarding does happen in-house and at the office for now.
Okay, thank you for that. We have another question that says the agency website phone number gives a voice message and then immediately hangs up. The chat bot on the website cannot answer my particular question regarding a problem with the online form, which is the only thing preventing me from filing my UI application. How can I get help today so that I can complete my application? It's been difficult for them to reach someone by phone because it keeps hanging up on them.
Sure. So whenever someone calls into our 866 number, if they cannot get through to us, that means that all of our lines that we have available are currently full. In regards to this particular individual, I won't say their name, I can see it. That's how I know. I've already got an email in regards to this person, so I will make sure that we reach out to them today to address their concerns.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I do know that our program managers who serve our communities, we've received phone calls at CMA regarding the process and application in which individuals are still having to look for jobs and also having to look for childcare at the same time. Some people have lost benefits for a week because they were told not to search for jobs and they did not, and then they had their benefits cut. Is there any advice that you can give to these particular individuals?
So the work search, there was a waiver through the executive order that they are not required to do a work search. So I would say if they were denied on that, they need to go ahead and file an appeal, which they can do through their portal. They don't even need to speak with anyone to do that.
Okay. I'm looking to see.
Oh, and the same with childcare. So if they're denied on any kind of availability, anytime you're denied on an issue that you don't agree with, you have appeal rights. So once you receive that decision, you have 10 days to file your appeal for it to be timely. So I would just say if you get something you don't agree with in regards to your availability or your separation, file an appeal.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. I am still perusing the chat box for any additional questions. Once again, we definitely appreciate our panelists, their expertise in answering these questions. For any of our attendees who are participating and listening, are there any further questions that someone may have for our panelists that has not already been asked and answered? I guess for our panelists, could you please give, if someone needed to reach out, the best way, should they just include their contact information in the chat function for a follow-up, or how should that best be done? It looks like we have another question after that.
So that's perfectly fine if they want to put their contact information in the chat function. However, how would we get that information back to us? Is that something that you guys can print out, email to us?
We will definitely have to look into that. Or what's the best way for them to do a follow-up, just so they can make sure that their file is being taken care of?
So what I would suggest is if you have someone who is having difficulty with just getting their initial claim filed into the system, if they would email you guys and you can route them to us. However, if someone is calling in regards to a status update, let's say they filed their claim 2 days ago and they're just checking on the status, it does take us anywhere from 7 to 14 days to process a claim through our system. So we would ask that you give us some of that time frame to actually process and handle issues that potentially may be holding your claim up from paying. After that, I would say then go ahead and try to call us through our 866 number. We do realize that it is busy, but as we spoke on earlier, we are working to get additional resources on the front end of our call line to be able to answer those calls in a faster, in a quicker fashion. However, if they are having issues with filing their initial claim, those are the people that we need to speak to immediately so that they can go ahead and get their application in our system.
Okay, thank you very much. We have a question about PEUC. What are the qualifications for PEUC? And will individuals who apply for it have to reapply, or will they be contacted like self-employed and gig workers?
That's going to depend on when the person exhausts. If someone is currently filing now, all you need to do is just keep on filing. And when we have the program up and running, we'll be able to reach out to you to inform you of what the next steps are. They're the same eligibility requirements as regular state unemployment insurance. So you need to be unemployed through no fault of your own. And then each week that you file a claim, you need to be able and available to work. And so those are the same requirements as they are under state unemployment insurance. We will be reaching out to all of the people that we're able to identify in our system who would be potentially eligible for that program, and providing them with additional information of what to do when we have that benefit program available.
Okay, thank you. We have a question from Facebook. The Facebook question says, I have someone that has received I am someone that has received $600, but has not been receiving the state part of the benefit. Every week, a claim is filed, but only $600 is being deposited, and the regular state benefit is not being deposited. How is this supposed to work? Is the $600 better than nothing, or is this working as it's intended?
Go ahead, Larissa.
Sorry. That seems to be very claim specific, but I will say in order to receive this additional $600, you have to be getting some kind of regular state UI unemployment benefits. There may be something else going in on the back end. So if you have child support, or you have an overpayment, or you have something going on where you owe the IRS or Department of Revenue money, those funds will come out of your unemployment check. So without being able to actually see this person's claim and the specifics on it, there may be, for them to get the $600, there may be something else going on.
Okay. To piggyback on Laretha's comment, there are two things that may apply to this. One is if you elected to have taxes withheld, then you're not going to get the full $600 amount. You're not going to get the full state weekly benefit amount. It's going to be reduced by the necessary state and federal taxes if you elected to have that withhold that. The second is if you have an existing overpayment that you owe the agency because you previously received benefits you were not eligible to receive, your state weekly benefit amount is going to be used to offset, in other words, to repay that money that you owe the agency. But since you are eligible to receive some state unemployment insurance benefits, even if we're keeping it to either pay child support or to recover a debt that's owed to due, you'll still get the $600. So that's another possibility for this scenario.
Okay, thank you. We have some more questions. It says, is there a maximum amount that an independent contractor can earn within a week before PUA benefits are going to be reduced?
That's going to be just like it is under state UI. So if you are on PUA and you work more than 29 hours, then you'd be considered full-time and not unemployed and therefore not eligible for PUA. Or if you earn whatever your state established weekly benefit amount is, if you earn more than that during the week, then you would also not be considered unemployed. As long as you work less than 29 hours and earn less than whatever your state weekly benefit amount is, you will receive some amount of state PUA benefits and through July 25th, the $600 on top of that.
Okay, thank you. We have another question, and this is a two-part question. This person says, I work multiple part-time jobs for my annual income. They've done this for the past 11 years. Most of it is a W-2 income, and a small part of the income comes from a 1099. This person earns over $20,000 annually this way. Does this adequately qualify them for UI? And also, they have a very small amount of private self-reported income, which does not provide them with a tax form. Do they need to include the self-reported income on their UI claim, or should they leave it off?
Okay. I would leave the, since you do have regular employment through W-2s, then I would at this stage leave that off. From what the question says, about $20,000 annually, the basic general monetary eligibility requirement is that during your base period, which is ordinarily the four oldest of the last five completed calendar quarters, so if you file today, that's going to be all of 2019. So if in all of 2019, you needed to earn at least, I think it's about $4,500 through the entire year, and you had to have worked in at least two quarters and earned wages in two quarters. As long as you hit those baseline requirements, you're going to have a monetarily eligible UI claim. And then your weekly benefit amount will be determined based on looking at the wages that you earned in your highest quarter.
A question, does your agency have a list of frequently asked questions and answers that the Commission for Minority Affairs can post on social media or link to through the website?
We do, and on our website, which is dew.sc.gov, Right on the front page is a section that we call the COVID Hub, and it's divided into different sections for employers and businesses that has a whole list of information that I think is a great resource for individuals and for business owners, and really for anyone who has questions about the process. And from there, a lot of information can be gathered that may even prevent a phone call or needing to reach us. We try to update as often as possible with different information. And so I think you can find a lot of answers to your questions right there.
Thank you. Once again, I am scanning the chat functions. And thank you. I just saw that it was posted for anyone who has questions regarding the COVID Hub for SEDU. If you go to dew.sc.gov/COVID-hub, you will be able to find that information, and we will make that available on our website. Looking for any further questions. As I'm scanning for some more questions, I didn't know if our panelists wanted to offer some other remarks of anything that some frequently asked questions that were possibly not asked today that would be a benefit to our attendees or anything of that nature.
So I will say, as I'm working through emails and speaking with claimants on a day-to-day basis, a question that does come up often from claimants and employers is, once the economy and businesses are back open, what do I need to do with my UI claim? Do I continue to file? Do I have to go back to work with my employer? So I just want to make sure that everyone is aware is that once your employer opens back up and calls you back to come back to work, you are required to accept your position back. There is a thing that we have here at our agency called an offer of work. And remember, for unemployment benefits, you have to be able, willing, and available to work. So when your employer gets back with us and says, hey, this person, I offered them their job back. They decided that they didn't want to come back. And it may be because of potentially childcare issues. It may be because wages, some people may be earning more than in their weekly benefit amount than they actually do day-to-day working with their employer. However, that you do have to return back to your work with your employer. They'll let us know that you didn't, and we potentially will cut off your benefits, or potentially you could end up with an overpayment. And as Paul talked about earlier, with overpayments, we do have to recoup that money back. So I just don't want anyone to be in a situation where they end up owing us money back during a time when they needed assistance.
Thank you very much. We have a question that says, do we have to file a claim every week once the application is approved?
So yes, that's going to be part of your weekly certification. What you're going to want to do is reach out, go onto your portal. There's going to be a link that says go to my homepage, and then under that link, I believe it says certify my weekly benefits. Click on that link. There's about 13 questions that it's going to ask you. Answer those questions. If you are working, it's going to ask you to report your hours and your earnings, so please make sure that you do that as well. And then at the end, it will certify, and if you don't have any availability issues or nothing else is going on with your claim, you should receive payment onto your debit card or direct deposit if you elected for that within 48 to 72 hours.
Thank you very much. Okay, so I've been monitoring the chat function, and it looks like that might be the final question. So once again, I wanted to, we have a question that pops up. It says, this is going for a correction. Was it stated earlier that funds would have to be paid back? And in what particular instance would funds need to be paid back from a person who has applied?
So typically funds do not have to be paid back. And so that came from if you end up getting an overpayment, meaning that you did not report your earnings correctly to us, your employer does report wages back to us on a quarterly basis. And if it's found that you weren't reporting your earnings, you could potentially end up with an overpayment and you would be responsible for paying those funds back. But if you're reporting your earnings and hours, and then you will be perfectly fine.
Okay. What about in regards to self-employment? Does that apply as well?
Yeah, the same requirements apply for self-employment. So if you perform some services and then you receive payment for those services, then you need to report those. And there's a slightly different wrinkle for the self-employed in terms of regular state UI. And if you're an employee and you're filing for benefits, you have to report the wages that you earned during the week in which you earned them, even if you haven't gotten paid. So that's how it works for employees. For the self-employed, they report when they receive the payment. So it's a slightly different thing for them, but they still have to report that income that they receive from their self-employment. And if we find out through an audit or some other mechanism later on that that person received income from self-employment during a week in which they received PUA benefits and did not report it to us, then that's going to result in an overpayment that that person may have to pay back. So it is very important that you report all of your wages if you're an employee during the week in which you earn them, and all of your income if you're self-employed during the week in which you receive the income, if you are filing for a benefit program.
Thank you. We're getting a lot of responses in the chat function talking about how this is a great call, great presenters with great information. A lot of people are being helped with the information that's being presented. One question that comes up is, will we host another one of these particular forums? And so we will definitely get together as agencies and try to schedule another one should those in the community feel that they have some more questions that need to be answered. So thank you for that particular question. Looking at the time, it is now 10:50. So I wanna give a few more seconds to see if there are any other questions from those who are in attendance for our experts here from the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce. Once again, I would like to thank them for their time, thank them for the information that they have presented. Any closing remarks before we adjourn today's webinar? Once again.
Hey, once again, this is Brent, and we just are really thankful for this opportunity. Like we've discussed before, we know this is a unique circumstance for a lot of individuals, employers, and everyone, and it's impacted people in ways that no one could have even thought through. So we know this is hard on a lot of people, but I do want to say this agency is committed to doing all we can to serving everyone, and we ask for just a little patience just with the volume that we do have, but we will get to everyone. We'll make sure that those who are due benefits receive those benefits. And we will do our best just to work as quickly and as we can to get through to everyone. So I just wanted to, we appreciate the opportunity to answer these questions, and we look forward to working together in the future.
Thank you very much. What I would like to say once again is to thank everyone with us today who's with the Department of Employment and Workforce. I know several people who work in the agency, and I can definitely attest to the hard work that they are doing right now to make sure that communities are being served during this difficult time. So once again, from the Commission for Minority Affairs, thank you very much for all of your efforts in helping South Carolinians through this very difficult time. Once again, I'm seeing a lot of thank yous from those who are in attendance here in the chat function. As we conclude on today, what I definitely want to do is thank our panelists once again, Mr. Famolari, who is the Deputy General Counsel with the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce, and also Mr. Phillips and Ms. Santiago as well. Mr. Phillips is the Unemployment Insurance Operations Director, and Ms. Santiago is with the Unemployment Insurance Special Projects. And so once again, thank you very much for your expertise and for your responses. On behalf of the Commission for Minority Affairs, especially our Board of Commissioners, and our Executive Director, Dr. Dolores DaCosta, I would like to thank everyone for participating in today's session. Once again, thank you to all of today's attendees. We hope that you learned much from today's unemployment insurance webinar, and that you received answers to the questions that will assist you as we continue to deal with this pandemic. As always, we ask that you please share this information with others who are in need of it. We would especially like to thank CMA staff and the staff members for the Department of Employment and Workforce for all of the hard work that they are doing through this COVID-19 pandemic. Let me pause right here for a second. I have a question that just popped up. Will persons get retroactive payments from the shutdown date once they are approved? I'm not sure if that was asked and answered earlier, but that's a question that just came through.
So yes, that goes back to making sure that you put the correct last day of work on your claim. When we see that, and you can call us and request a back date on your claim, it's just a conversation. That's when we talked about just being, we are being very flexible right now because we realize that people are having some problems with getting their claim filed or getting to us to get assistance with filing their claim over the phone. But yes, they would receive retroactive payments.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And once again, monitoring, seeing no further questions. Once again, thank you for all of our attendees for attending today's session. Thank you for today's panelists, once again, for your expertise in helping out community members. And of course, thank you to the Commission for Minority Affairs for the hard work that is being done in our communities. Once again, should you have need of us, please do not hesitate to contact the Commission for Minority Affairs. And of course, please contact the South Carolina Department of Employment and Workforce should you have any questions as well. We ask that everyone please stay safe, please stay home if you can. And in all things, as we said before, please stay safe, please socially distance, and please make sure that you're taking care of yourself, your neighbors, and your family and others. Once again, thank you and have a great day.
Thank you.
Thank you.